Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there from the Sunbury Motors Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, all new pre-owned inventory. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Excellent service department and sales staff, as always, and lots to get into today. College football playoff rankings, lots and lots of NFL news. The World Series is done. Braves win for the first time since 95. So we'll get into the college football rankings first because I have a lot to say about that, and then we'll get Steve's take. And we are scheduled to have ESPN's Heather Dinich at 4:06 today. And I'll be curious to hear from her as well on this topic. So as you saw last night, Georgia, Alabama, Michigan State, Oregon, your top four. Ohio State, 5. Cincinnati, 6 on the outside looking in. Penn State, not included in the top 25, which I can't say is earth-shattering surprising. But I do have a small beef with that. But let me start with the top four first, because that's where my biggest beef is. And once again, it is an absolute disgrace that the College Football Playoff Committee continues to pick on Group of Five teams. Why is it that we include the Group of Five in all this if we're basically just going to ignore what they do? This is an 8-0 team that's done everything that they've been asked in terms of on their schedule, which they can't even control themselves. And they've been the number two team on the AP poll for the last few weeks. And even that was even a surprise. So that, to me, tells me something. I get they only have one win. Good win, let's say. Notable win, and that was at Notre Dame. The Indiana game we thought might have been a notable win, but it turns out it's not the case because Indiana is not a great team. So you look at the rest of these teams. Georgia, obviously not a surprise. Alabama, fine. Michigan State, deservedly so, especially after the way they came back against Michigan. That's fine. So that leads me to Oregon as leading the question of, well, who are you going to take out if you're going to put Cincinnati in? You compare Cincinnati and you compare Oregon. Cincinnati, obviously the better record. But when you look at both their schedules, they each only have one of those signature wins. For Oregon, that's Ohio State. And Oregon lost to a not-so-great Stanford team as their lone loss. Cincinnati, of course, again, beat Notre Dame. So, is Oregon in there because of the Power 5 sort of things? And I get the Pac-12 hasn't had a big presence in the college football playoff, and this is the first time Oregon's in. So maybe I understand that part of it. But if we're gonna talk about these having signature wins and the strength of schedule and this and that and either an unblemished record or maybe one loss, then let's follow that formula correctly. And let's not just think about the money, even though I know where this is. I'm not naive to not think that. But again, there is the hypocrisy again with these polls in college football, whether it's the AP, whether it's the coaches, whether it's the college football playoff committee. The hypocrisy continues. And this also shows that this playoff needs an expansion, because then you can include the Cincinnati team. And sure, we'll probably still have gripes about where exactly they're ranked, but at least in an expanded playoff, they would be in. But in this case, still with four teams, they're not. They're sixth. They're still behind Ohio State. And Cincinnati's coach was on the Dan Patrick Show earlier today. And maybe we'll get a chance to play some of his audio from that. But I think he said it best.
What are you ranting about now?
My dislike again for the college football playoff committee and ranking and everything in general. The hypocrisy that is in college football.
They speak highly of you.
I'm done with this. Like, this is ludicrous.
How can you be done with it? It's the system.
I know it's a system, but I mean, this shows you we need an expansion, number one, with this whole Cincinnati thing. I just think it's a disgrace that Cincinnati's not in the top four. It is. I'm sorry. I don't care if they're a group of five. I don't care about their strength of schedule. They can't control that. They've done what they've asked. They beat Notre Dame. They should be in the top four right now.
All right. So let's start with the Notre Dame part. One of the problems in polls over the years has always been you get extra credit in college basketball if you beat Duke, and you get extra credit in college football if you beat Notre Dame. Notre Dame is a good team, not a great team. I'm 3-6 Wake Forest. We beat Duke. All right, we're ranked 23rd. Wait a minute. Hold on. That's happened far too often over time. And that now goes to the problem with Alabama. It's actually more Alabama than Cincinnati. Look, Cincinnati's coming off a brilliant performance against Tulane, who didn't have its starting quarterback and is 1-7 and barely won. Okay. I mean, that's going to be their issue moving forward. They have no cachet. They have no cachet. And it's the world they live in. It is who you are. You're Cincinnati. That's who you are. And you can't help that your schedule is something that if Penn State played that schedule, the hue and cry of the Penn State fan would be like, why are we playing these people? How come we're not playing somebody tougher? You got to put it in that context. You're not sitting there and you're not playing Iowa 1 week, Ohio State the next, playing Auburn, playing Wisconsin. These aren't the teams they're playing. I mean, that's half of Penn State's schedule right there. You played at Wisconsin, played at Iowa, played at Ohio State, played Auburn. I mean, that's half your schedule. That's not half of Cincinnati's schedule. Cincinnati doesn't play any of those teams. Any one of those four is an upgrade over what Cincinnati's played so far. It's going to be a problem. It's just a fact of life. It's just the way it is. Because what happens is this, and this is where Cincinnati, oh, yeah, they're winning, they're undefeated. Hey, guess what? When Ohio State just played Penn State, how tough, hard, and physical was that game?
It was.
Guess what? You got to come back and play the next week. And you got to do that every week. Penn State has got to finish with Michigan, Rutgers, and Michigan State after they play Maryland. Who's got a better schedule, Penn State or Cincinnati? If Penn State had Cincinnati's schedule, they're home free. It's a fact of life. Ohio State's got to finish with Michigan State at home and at Michigan. Really? Does Cincinnati have to do that? The problem is not just who you play, it's the sequencing of who you play. And you go out with a tough, pounding physical game, right? You know, I mean, Michigan's got to bounce back from their loss after it was a tough, pounding, hard-fought physical game with Michigan State. They got to come back out and they got to play again. And Michigan still has to play Penn State and they still got to play Ohio State. Michigan State still has to play, okay, Ohio State and Penn State. Ohio State still has to play Michigan State and Michigan. Okay? And Cincinnati has to play SMU? Really? And that's what you're gung-ho about? That's the problem. And they can't help the conference they're in. They can't. Okay? I understand that. But it's also a fact of life that you gotta live with. It's just the way it is. Now, the problem I've got is with Alabama. Alabama lost. Their two big wins are Mississippi and Mississippi State. Really? Really? I mean, the same Mississippi Auburn just, like, knocked around and won by two scores at that Mississippi? Really? That's the problem I have. The problem I have is that I talk all the time, in every sport. Every team is an entity unto itself. It is not a carryover from the previous team. You lose players, you sign players, whether transfer portal or... Okay, look at Michigan State. Is Michigan State 2021 the same team as Michigan State 2020? No, of course not. People look at them as an entity unto themselves, but they don't look at Alabama as an entity unto themselves. They're an entity unto themselves. The same entity that, by the way, fell way behind at Texas A&M, to which, by the way, was playing its backup quarterback, and lost. I mean, they lost to Texas A&M's backup quarterback. Everybody knows that, right? Everybody understand that?
Yep. And I also... I have a bigger problem with Oregon than Bama, but I agree. Bama should not be in this either.
Oregon beat Ohio State in Columbus. Okay, without its best player and without another key player. Oregon won the game in Columbus. They should be ahead of Ohio State. They beat them without their best player and without another key player, because Thibodeau did not play in the game. You know that, right?
Yes, I remember. The only thing I would say with Oregon is I think they have similar issues. Them and Cincinnati have similar issues because they both have one signature win, and both of their schedules stink
before and after this. But Oregon beat the team that is right next to them, and they beat them in their place. That's why they're ahead of them. Now, how well would Cincinnati do in the Pac-12? I don't know. I don't know. Right, in the Big Ten, Cincinnati would get its fair share of wins, but it also, I would say Cincinnati in the Big Ten would be 8-4 at the best. Because it's not that you're not good. The problem is that the sequencing of games... All right, let's play Minnesota. They pound the pound, pound, pound. You know, guess what? You get sore and you get hurt in a game like that. And the problem is you got to play the next week. Okay? No offense, you don't get pounded by Tulane. They're not a physical team. And they're out there with their backup quarterback, because with the starting quarterback, Tulane actually gave Oklahoma a pretty good run in Norman, no less. But that kid couldn't play. And Cincinnati struggled its brains. I watched some of that game with Tulane. I watched some of them thinking, this is not good. I said, they're not going to make the top four. When you're playing a schedule that week, you have you have big problems. That's why, you know, now Alabama should not be second. They shouldn't be. Okay? They are getting bonus points for the brand name. It doesn't mean at the end they're not second. It doesn't mean at the end they're not one. But you can't sit there and go, that's Alabama. No, it's Alabama 2021. Every team is an entity unto itself, and the College Football Playoff Committee, a group that should know such things, doesn't seem to know that. Now, I would have probably put Cincinnati fourth. I probably would have put them fourth, but as the time goes and other teams keep winning, because Michigan State and Ohio State will work itself out. They play each other. Okay, that'll work itself out. But as time goes, there's a good chance that I would start them at four, have them in the weekly snapshot. But as each weekly snapshot goes, they'd be getting closer and closer to being out because the schedule just gets weaker and weaker. And that's a big problem. There's nothing left. Cincinnati is like Gonzaga. Gonzaga basketball loads up its non-conference schedule because Mark Few knows that's the only way to show everybody they belong. Because once they get to the West Coast Conference for 2.5 months, they disappear. Cincinnati is Gonzaga basketball. Matt doesn't like me saying that because a win over Notre Dame should put you to number four.
All I'm saying is Oregon and Bama do not need to be in this. They're not deserving right now. And Cincinnati should be one of those two spots right now.
Oregon beat Ohio State in Columbus without their best player. That's pretty darn impressive. There is nobody that gave Oregon a chance because Thibodeau wasn't playing. Now, since then, what's happened to Oregon? Why has Oregon struggled? Because Verdell, who had over 200 yards rushing in that game, got hurt and is out for the season. I feel like I'm educating everybody here. Back with more in a moment as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK, the home of the Macatrillo Rant.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Subaru Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
I always feel like the Macatrillo rant is good because it allows him to get the toxins out of his system.
It is very cathartic sometimes.
Gets to go home, play with the kids. He's not angry because he's got it out of his system. Because when you look at the teams that he roots for, there are a lot of toxins.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory, great pre-owned inventory. fabulous sales staff that works with you and an outstanding service department. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hubbell's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Just want to make sure you're feeling better.
I am. Thank you.
Seem to be angry about a lot of things.
It's just these sorts of things, but it's okay. I'll get over it.
Are you sure? I'm concerned.
I mean, at the end of the day, none of my dogs that I have involved in this are have a shot, so it is what it is.
Okay. Well, we'll get to the playoff part in the last half hour. How about that? Because they're meeting today and tomorrow about that. I'm sure the suit told you all about that. He's on top of the college football world.
Oh, yeah.
See? Confirmation. Yeah, it sounded a little sarcastic, but yeah. Okay.
S-U-I-T. That spells suit.
It's an odd world we live in, my man, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
The king of Ward 4. All right. Let's bring in Donnie Collins. Scranton Times-Tribune. Outstanding guy. Great reporter. Donnie, welcome back. So great to have you with us.
Always a pleasure for me, Steve.
Okay. Donnie, so let's get this evaluation from you. They're two-thirds of the way through the season. They're coming off the Ohio State game. So where do you think the Penn State team is right now?
I'm going to give you the boring take here because I really believe it, but I think this has been a pretty good season for Penn State. I think if you could eliminate Clifford getting hurt, I think they're a 7-1 team, and they're right where everybody pretty much would have dreamed they'd be in the beginning of the season. I think they've grown in some areas. I think they've overcome a lot, especially on the defensive line. I mean, nobody really talks about it. They've lost some really, really big time defensive linemen, Isaac, PJ during the season, and they've done a good job coming back. They've done a really good job out of the portal. I mean, they've gotten some really good players that have become leaders, that have become invaluable players. I think it's been an overall positive season. Now the only drawback is they aren't 7-1. Clifford did get hurt, and they're 5-3. They're on a 3-game losing streak. But right. I think we saw a lot last week against Ohio State that would lead you to believe that this is not a team that's going to spiral down the stretch. I think this team has a really good shot to finish strong. And then in a month we talk again about where were they. I think there's a rosier outlook on that.
Okay, so now let's get to last Saturday night. What did you see Saturday night that reinforced the evaluation you just gave?
Well, I think I saw a lot of what I thought they'd do if they played really well. You know, I thought they moved the ball on offense. Clifford did look healthy. Those receivers, especially, Parker Washington. When Parker Washington has a game, these guys are really good. I mean, they're an offense. That's when their offense is their best, is when they're getting Parker Washington involved. And I think it's because they're getting more than one guy involved in the passing game. They're throwing the ball better. I think that's why that happens. I don't think it's, he needs to do a certain amount every week. I just think they need to get him involved a little more. And, I think they did a lot of really good things. Their run defense is what it had been all year. I mean, only one team had run for more than 4 yards a carry against them heading into that game. Two, Illinois and Auburn did. But it was barely. But, they did a good job doing what I thought they would do. Now, I think in a lot of ways, and here's where I have a little bit hotter take, as they say today, but I think that was in some ways the most disappointing loss they had all season, because they were healthy and the turnovers got them again. In a big spot, it happened last year in the beginning of the year, didn't happen for 9 straight games. Now it's happened a couple of times where turnovers came back and bit them a little bit, not just turning the ball over, but when they get a turnover, not scoring and giving it right back. So I think there's some negatives to what happened on the turnover side of it. But, you can't argue with how Clifford played. You can't argue that the line wasn't a lot more physical than it had been. and that for a little bit in that game, at least, they were running the ball a little bit better than they had. And the passing game is what it was supposed to be. And I think they defended Ohio State better than teams have defended Ohio State all year. So I wouldn't be surprised if by the end of the year that's the best team Ohio State played in the conference or in the regular season.
I get a feeling in listening to Ryan Day, I think they think that. You can just sense by how he's saying things that they think that. And let's face it, what do turnovers and points off of turnovers mean? Well, Ohio State had 10 points off of turnovers in a game they won by 9. That the math tells you everything you need to know about it. What is it about Sean Clifford that has allowed him to flourish this year?
I think there's a lot of things. I think number first and foremost, I think he's a really good player, and I don't think that showed a lot last season. But he's got a lot of skills. He has a really good arm. He could fire the ball in there. When he gets time, he makes the throw. When he's healthy, he can. I think he moves around the pocket pretty well. He could throw on the run. He can make plays with his legs, and he's gotten a chance to do all of that makes him a good player this year. They've put him in positions to succeed. And I think and he's done it. What impresses me most about him is he's done it in a situation where he's the running game. There really hasn't been anything consistent out of the backs this year. There just hasn't been. And at some point you move on with that. I think you just say, hey, we get what we can, and we proceed. But Clifford's given them a running game, and teams don't have to honor what Penn State does outside of him in the running game. And he's been able, when he's healthy, to move the ball on some pretty good teams through the air. He's done it pretty consistently. The Ohio State defense, everybody talked all week last week about how improved they were in the secondary from the first couple of games of the season. And Clifford, I thought, he played very well. I mean, he turned the ball over twice, but it wasn't like last year where he was making critical mistakes. The interception, he was under a lot of pressure. Probably shouldn't have thrown it, but he's trying to make a play, and you don't have a lot of time at that point. I can forgive that one. The fumble is not his fault. So I mean, he was actually trying to protect the ball when it happened. So I think, I just see his skills coming through in a different way this year, and I a lot of credit I think probably goes to Mike Yurcich, but a lot more probably goes to Clifford for saying, hey, look, I'm a better player than I was last year, and I'm gonna clean up some stuff that they've been asking me to clean up. I mean, this is a guy who lost his job last year, and now he's unquestionably the most valuable player on this offense to me.
Right. Yeah. No. I mean, no question about that. What does it tell everybody about the quality of Jahan Dotson? That in a game, in every game, he is the number one. Like, we must stop 5. And in the first half, he had, what, 3 catches? He ended up with 11 in the game. 11. The must-stop guy got 11.
He not only is he the must-stop guy, he's the guy. He got a freshman cornerback during the week who said, I don't think he's anything I can't handle. And I would expect a guy to say that. I really would. But then he goes out and gets it. They were double teaming him. They did some things to try to take the ball away from him, especially in the first half. And as the game went on, they were still doing some of those things, and Penn State adjusted. And what really impresses me about Dotson is you look at Ohio State. They probably have, let's face it, three of their starting defensive backs are probably going to be multi-year starters in the NFL. I mean, because they always are. And he's done this against them twice. Yeah. He's had this kind of game against Ohio State twice, back to back. Now they haven't shown that they can cover the guy, and they haven't not only that they haven't even shown they can deny him the ball. So right. I think he's been different circumstances. I hate to keep mentioning the injury because it happened. You move on, but Clifford getting hurt probably cost Dotson a really good shot at some major awards this year, and there was a time in the beginning of the year where he was as impactful an offensive player as anybody in college football. He's been that good. I'd love to see him get some more chances in the punt return game. I think he could be a good kickoff returner too, but the game's not played that way anymore. But I think he's definitely the best playmaker that they've had in a couple of years now, and he just continues to do some amazing things. And yeah, I was. You look down at the stat sheet. There's some things you look down at, and when you're watching the game, and you're not following the stat sheet super closely. You're just kind of watching the flow of the game. You miss out on. You look down at the end of the game with Dotson. You had 11 catches for however many hundred some yards he had, but that seems like about right, because it seems like he's always kind of that involved in what they're doing, and nobody could prevent that.
And not only that, the running touchdown he had as well. On top of it, getting the ball into his hands, ultra important. And again, it's one thing to be, with all due respect, Parker or Keandre Lambert-Smith and do that. It's like, okay, they were concentrating on Dotson. Dotson's getting it, and they're concentrating on him. And as for the freshman corner for Ohio State, okay, learn this lesson. Tell your teammates you can handle them. Tell the media, said, look, it'll be a tough assignment, but we're working hard on it. That's all you got to do.
Yeah, it's one thing to believe you can slow down John Dotson.
Yeah.
They haven't been able to. And I think the one thing that, I said it in the press box when he had that rushing touchdown. Like, man, you wish that he got the ball in his hands a few more times in the overtime a week before. Because I don't know if Illinois would have been able to continually stop Dotson. He's just that kind of a player that you just expect that no matter what somebody tries to do to slow him down, and I'm not even going to say stop him because nobody has, but when you try to slow him down, you still can't do it, especially when you see Ohio State not be able to do it. That's super impressive.
Right, exactly. What's your thoughts on the matchup this week with Maryland?
I think that's not many people are talking. I understand 1-0. That's the answer to every question, really. It's a brilliant strategy. Just always say 1-0. But I think what happened last year is not forgotten. And I could see Penn State coming out and playing a great game this weekend, because they're not going to sleep on Maryland here. I've heard people say, one loss tends to lead to the next with this team, and I don't tend to buy that, because that's always such a, every game is such an entity in and of itself, and there's things that happen in every single game that determines what goes on that day, who's playing, who's injured, what's the situation with players, everything like that. But I think Penn State's, outside of TJ, pretty healthy coming into this game. I think this team seems ready for a win, and I don't think what happened last year is going to be lost on these guys. I think they're going to go in ultra focused, and James said at his press conference yesterday, kind of threw it in at the end because nobody asked about it, but he said, we have seen what happened last, we do remember what happened last year, and we've studied it, we've looked at it, and I thought that was interesting for him to mention something that happened in the past. Mm-hmm. But I do think Penn State will play very well this week, but they're going to have to, Tagovailoa is a good quarterback.
Yep.
Obviously, Jarrett's a heck of a receiver, gave him a whole lot of problems last year. But I think that, this is a very different secondary than they had last season, and this is a very different defensive line. I think Ebba Cady could give Tagovailoa some problems this week. Yeah. and force them into some of the mistakes that they're prone to make, too.
It's always interesting when something's volunteered. That tells you some mindset.
I always say James's press conferences are interesting because he will volunteer information if you're looking for it.
Donnie, always a pleasure. Thank you so much for your time. Can't wait to see you Saturday.
I'll be there, Steve. Can't wait.
Donnie Collins, Scranton Times-Tribune. You notice what Donnie didn't do there, Matt?
He didn't go crazy?
Rant. We'll come back with more.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, I forgot, because Philadelphia fans are honest.
That's exactly right. But he's a Scranton guy. He should understand, too,
Why? Because you watch The Office and you think that's how Scranton is?
No, that is definitely untrue. Just like the Jersey Shore is not how the Jersey Shore actually is either.
Well, but see, that's a suit problem. That's envy. kid from Benton always wanted to live in Jersey Shore, parts of Jersey Shore, better than Ward 4. I mean, it's really like, you know, the color of green when he goes there.
Oh, my almighty!
Their team's better. They're better on a consistent basis. Yeah, all right. I'm just telling you, it's, I think it has a lot to do with it. Philadelphia fans, we're honest. Okay. Do you think the fan base plays any role in the lack of championships?
No, I honestly don't. I think it's more of management and coaching.
You don't think, like, for example, running the team down doesn't play a role?
No.
Really? Because we're honest.
New York's the same way. They got tons of championships.
Actually, they don't. The Yankees do. The Mets have two. The Jets have one. The Knicks have two. The Rangers have three. Okay. Where are all the championships?
Giants have four.
Giants have four. Okay. That's it. But the Knicks have two. The Rangers have three. The Mets have two. All right. Nets have none. I think I think it plays a little bit bigger role than you think. Now, you got to be a little bit tougher to play in there. I'm going to remember what. Ed Whitson? Was it Ed Whitson? Who could pitch everywhere but couldn't pitch for New York. Some people can't play in that environment. They just can't. Some people thrive in it. Doug in Wellsboro. Dougie!
Steven, how are you?
Doing well, sir. It's so good to hear from you.
I saw you on an adventure on your flight back from Columbus. We were following you in flight aware. I saw that diversion into Harrisburg, but that was fun.
Yeah, we had a great time. James came up to me on Sunday night, and he said, "Hey, what time did you walk in your house?" I said, 6:45. He goes, "Yeah, same time I did," because he's got to go out to Port Matilda. Jack and I had to go out to the airport to get our cars, and then I had to go home. It happens, and remember, part of the reason it's happening is because right now you're short-staffed in a lot of areas. The airport was short-staffed. The bus was short-staffed. I mean, that played a role in it, besides fog.
Are you busing down to Maryland?
Yes. Yeah, I decided not to drive. I decided to just take the team bus. So, yeah, we're busing there.
For Sean, what do you think will happen? Will he come back for another year to play with Liam at all? Will that factor into it?
I think that's
going
to be
now.
I think that's going to be a conversation that we will hear that will happen. I think that conversation will happen. Just like I think the conversation with PJ Mustipher will happen. And when will we know? We'll either know before January 1 or just after January 1. Everybody has to declare, every senior has to declare what they're doing because of the COVID year. That's why last year it's like, why is this guy announcing for the draft? He had to last year. It's the same story this year. They're going to have to declare whether they're coming back or not. So between December 15th, Doug, and January, when's the title game? 10th? So it'd be between December 15th and January 17th, people will make announcements.
When do they get their NFL evals?
It should be in 3 to 4 weeks.
Okay.
Right in that range. It's right around Thanksgiving, give or take.
Okay. Last thing, Wellsboro is in the playoffs. We'll play South Williamsport on Saturday.
I saw that. I've got that on my list here.
Yeah, well, look on who's on the other side of the bracket, Steve. Look at the other, look right above it, who's on the other side of the bracket. We're
Saturday
District 4.
At 1 o'clock, and then opportunity awaits.
Come on, opportunity.
Well, they should have lost one game, and they did lose a game.
Yeah, okay.
Opportunity awaits. Okay? Great moments happen from great opportunity.
You're not beating Southern Columbia with 17 kids, no matter how good those 17 kids are.
Now I feel like I'm talking to Matt again.
I'm going to kill him. You're talking to the suit now.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
There is no way that is happening.
Hold on one second. Vegas holding on two. Well, good luck this week.
Yeah, well, that'll be. We'll see. Is James going to be at the college? Or is James going to be at the field tomorrow night?
Will James? Yes, he will be.
Okay. Okay, yeah, that's all I have for today. So yeah, thank you very much.
He'll be there from 6:30 to 7. I'll be there at 6:05.
That was amazing.
Boy. What a great moment for you to be compared to one of the giants of broadcasting.
I love Doug.
Doug? Doug is the greatest. Doug is the greatest. See, I wish, to be honest with you, see, I'm one of those people, I wish Learfield would just let us take calls. I miss so much taking calls on the pregame show when we're on the road. I miss that a lot. I really do. Yeah, I understand for Learfield, it's a logistical problem. It's a personnel problem. There's a lot that goes. There's actually more to it than people realize. You got to have somebody that's screening calls and and somebody running the board. It takes more personnel to do it. That's one of the reasons they don't do it. But jeez, yeah, I do miss taking calls like that. So on this show. If somebody asks me, what's my favorite part of this show? My favorite part of the show is when we take calls. Easily. I love talking to people on the show. Even if it's not positive. It doesn't have to be positive, whatever. You know? So. Okay. I know we're headed to the top. I know we missed all these commercials. I know at some point Matt will attempt to make up for it. So I probably won't even be on the last half hour because of the commercials, right?
We'll make it work.
Well, no, I mean, I'm just thinking, I wonder if I can leave early. What?
Let's just say we might have a bigger break going into the final half hour.
Hey. I mean, the suit leaves 10:30 every single morning. Roger just doesn't know. Oh, until now. Oh, sorry. I feel awful for revealing that. You should see. Did you see the list of restaurants he goes to? Holy mackerel.
Who, Roger or the suit?
Oh, the suit?
Yes.
I got. And not only that, for some odd reason, I run into all the clients he claims he took out, and they go, no, I didn't see him. Now, what does that mean? One guy's from the IRS. He was curious.
That's why I leave it to that side of the building.
Don't look at me. I was just talking. You're-